BBC Audio presents Series 1 to 4 of Life at Absolute Zero. Welcome to Meridian Cliffs, located at exactly 0 degrees 0 minutes west and 0 degrees 0 minutes east. This is where the Greenwich Meridian meets the Channel, and where time stands poised at absolute zero. These 26 beautifully observed and gently comic stories are written and read by Lynne Truss, directed by Kate McCall, and are a peer production for BBC Radio 4.
At Meridian Cliffs, on the south coast of England, there is a certain tough but defeatist quality in the people that is, you can't help thinking, entirely environmental in its origins. Due to the constant battering wind from the sea, there is a tendency amongst the locals to walk in a particular stompy, flat-footed kind of way. At rest, they also lean at an angle, as if into the wind, and even indoors they shout, as if into the teeth of a gale. When they go shopping in nearby Brighton, all this telltale tilting, stomping and yelling certainly marks them out from the crowd. The first time I met Sarah Burkett at a bus stop, I knew at once she was from Meridian Cliffs by the way she said, "Bus is late, but what can you do?" But it's not just the wind you have to worry about at Meridian Cliffs. There is also rampant coastal erosion. Since its foundation in 1921, the settlement has lost at least 15% of its original surface area, as the cliffs have crumbled and dropped, sometimes taking quite popular landmarks along with them. You may have heard the expression, "there goes the neighbourhood." In Meridian Cliffs, "there goes the neighbourhood" means something quite different from what it usually means anywhere else in Britain. When the settlement was founded, just after the First World War, it was initially christened Armistice on Sea as the result of a newspaper competition. Few regret that the name didn't stick. Other commemorative names were also mooted, but then, one day, someone drew a line on a map and realised that the Prime Meridian ran right through the site, the same one that runs through Greenwich, which meant that it was the place where you were not only 0 degrees, 0 minutes west, but also, amazingly, 0 degrees, 0 minutes east. And so the name Meridian Cliffs was coined. There were great ambitions at first. Picture postcard images from the 1920s show optimistic entrepreneurial ventures, restaurants and tea shops, and places selling souvenirs and knick-knacks. It's as if Meridian Cliffs were a proper functioning seaside resort. The grassy tops of the cliffs were even advertised as an ideal place for picnicking. But maybe it was the way all the sandwiches blew away unless they were weighted down with rocks. Or maybe it was the way enormous seagulls routinely strafed the scene like enemy aircraft. Or maybe, and yes, on balance it was probably this, it was the great picnic collapse disaster of 1936 that was to blame. But holidaying at Meridian Cliffs soon became something that nobody would dream of. The town was very sorry for what had happened to those poor unwary picnickers in 1936, by the way. So much so that for decades after the picnic disaster, a party of Meridionians, led by the now elderly founder of the place, George Burkett, would mark its anniversary with a solemn ceremony. Little Sarah Burkett, holding hands with Grandpa George, still remembers being among those who used to gather at a guano-caked plinth on the clifftop, which was topped by a life-size bronze representation of a picnic basket. But then, in 1972, the entire cliff, plinth, basket and all, collapsed just after the Burkett party had walked away from it, and they decided then that enough was enough. Now the wind has won. Meridian Cliffs has surrendered. George Burkett is no more. His granddaughter is glad he didn't live quite long enough to see his town wave its white flag, lie down and give up the ghost completely. Pretty balustrades have disappeared, and what was once an elegantly fronted, fine dining establishment is now a plate-glass windowed betting shop with its back turned firmly to the sea. Today, people often pass through Meridian Cliffs without realising they've even been through a town, although for a while there was a sign that caught one's eye from the bus on the outskirts to the north. Potatoes, it said, and underneath someone had wittily written, "Twinned with pomme de terre." Sarah Burkett is 53 now. She works as a care assistant at a nearby hospital for the blind. Her ex-husband Jim moved from neighbouring New Haven when they were married, and he moved back there when they split up 15 years ago. He has a number of stepkids now, and another kid of his own, and annoys Sarah by constantly talking about how great it is to live at sea level. When they talk on the phone, he also often reminds her that there's no need to shout. Sarah thinks of herself as happy enough, but she does find Jim irritating for the way he denigrates Meridian Cliffs. But then she's equally irritated by the adorable young professional couple next door, whose only crime is to think that Meridian Cliffs is terrific. The thing is, they've moved here from overcrowded, overpriced Brighton, and they can't get over how clever they've been. "Out here, you can park your car right in front of your house," they thrill. She smiles at them, waves at them, and agrees that the parking in Brighton is abominable, but she still finds herself saying, as she closes her front door behind her. But her main source of irritation, of course, is her daughter Jess. Jess is single, 32 years old, and has worked at the same hairdressers in Brighton for more than 10 years. She is an agreeable daughter in all respects except one. She just won't leave home. She has no desire to. And Sarah doesn't understand it. It was their ancestors' vision that established this place, a vision of homes for all. And three generations down the line, here's someone who doesn't even want one. To her credit, Jess really loves her mum. At the hairdresser's, while she's putting highlight foils into women's hair or scissoring a fringe, she often talks about how cool her mum is for putting up with her, for cooking her dinner every night and sometimes making clothes for her. She's brilliant at sewing. The clients sometimes say, speaking awkwardly at her reflection in the mirror, "Wouldn't you like a home of your own, Jess?" And she says, expertly tipping their head sideways, "What for?" She has no idea that each evening, when she puts her key in the lock, her mother physically cringes. On days when the wind is direct from the sea, Jess gets home more quickly, being blown right up the road from the bus stop. At the hospital for the blind, which sits on a hill, Sarah can monitor wind direction, and it honestly cheers her up to think of Jess being held up a bit when the breeze goes west-east instead of the usual south-north. On those blessed crosswind days, Sarah gets home, goes upstairs to Jess's room, and sits there for a quiet few minutes. She pictures it stripped of Jess's bed and pink dressing table and her collection of nail varnishes and her widescreen TV. In their place, she sees a proper tailor's dummy and an oak sewing table and a floor-length mirror and a little chest of drawers full of bobbins and threads and paper patterns and the Daniel Craig calendar from 2013, open at August, hanging to nobody's jocular disapproval right on the back of the door. Sarah did have a moment of hope. 3 years ago, a patient at the Home for the Blind left her enough money to put a 50% deposit on a nearby flat for Jess. She knew it was a risky plan, but it backfired far more badly than she could have anticipated. She wonders now why she handled the presentation of the news to Jess so tactlessly. But she was excited by the idea of the Daniel Craig Memorial Sewing Room and just couldn't help herself. She'd downloaded the floor plan to show Jess. She had stuck coloured labels on the furniture allocated for Jess to take. She had also worked out a schedule of fortnightly visits home. Jess's reaction was to burst into tears. She was wounded to the heart. Perhaps the swatches of wallpaper and curtain material stuck to a professional-looking mood board had been taking things a bit far. "I thought you'd be pleased," said Sarah, which was a lie, of course, but definitely the right line to take in the circumstances. "Oh, Mum," wailed Jess. "Look at the people next door," said Sarah. "They're younger than you. They've got started." "You hate the people next door." "No, I don't. I've heard you imitating them. Ooh, our house would be double the price in Brighton." "But, babe, don't you want to start your own life?" said Sarah. And poor Jess, who thought her life had started quite a long time ago, actually, were so deeply hurt that she bent double in her grief.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.